So for those of you who don't know Selma, she is does a lot of different cool things in HRI. She's actually also the general co-chair of HRI this next year, and she was the program co-chair last year?
The year before.
So she actually is well in tune with what the rest of the field is doing. She also knows about us a little bit. You may have caught this kind of greeting right here between Reed and Selma. She did a stint here in 2005, visiting here.
You're not supposed to say the dates of anything.
I don't want to suck up time.
When she was 18 years old.
So I don't want to suck up any more time, so
cool.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Aaron. So I'm Selma. I'm at Indiana University, Bloomington. And I'm just going to tell you from the start, I'm a social scientist. So I do human-robot interaction work from a social science perspective. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that today, but just to give you a little bit more of my origin story, as you were mentioning, I was here in 2005 as a visiting researcher, and my goal for my PhD was to study, not study robots or HRI, but actually to study you, and Reed was very kind and generous and let me into his lab, so I got to do some, this is me first observing the roboticists. And then it was so fascinating that I got sucked into working with the roboticists. So this is actually a little snippet of the first HRI study that I ever did in my life with Grace, who I hear is in a museum. So just to give you a little bit of kind of knowledge of where I came from. And so I'm especially happy to be here because I don't think I've been here in many, many years, but it's always wonderful. It's kind of like home in a sense. Being here, so thank you for inviting me, thank you for having me. So just to give you a little bit of a kind of heads up on what I'm going to talk about today, as I mentioned, I come from the social sciences, particularly from a field called science and technology studies, where what we're really curious about is how do people and technologies interact, and not just kind of one-on-one, but how do technologies kind of interact with people on a more, how can we study it at a societal or organizational level? So today I'm going to kind of mention a little bit of what I learned early on in terms of looking at robotics and maybe how we frame what we're doing in terms of robots assisting people or robots being in the world, and talk a little bit about kind of conceptual framings, how we can think about it. And then give you a case study, particularly focusing on kind of different projects that we've done over the years in socially assistive robotics, mostly in elder care, to tell you how we might be able to take a kind of societal or more socially centered view on human-robot interaction and how to design and implement robotic technology. So I'm sure you've all seen these kinds of pictures are, you know, the vision that what we're trying to do these days is get robots out there in more and more open environments, in people's homes, in hospitals, in educational institutions, so interacting with diverse kinds of people in diverse places. And so what I studied initially was just even the vision of how do roboticists see and think about robots' place and what human interactions might be when we have them in these open-ended environments. And this is just kind of a picture from a Japanese magazine, and this is from Bill Gates' article about what we might see about robots being in every home. And if we look at also some of the different things that robotics researchers might say about how robots could be in society. You know, we see that maybe robots can help people live more easily. That's definitely what all of us want, right? We think about what kind of impacts they might have. There are expectations that maybe these kinds of technologies can help us have a better quality of life, right? You do that kind of work here as well. Or as in this quote, this is from Hiroshi Ishiguro, who builds androids. You know, we might even see that robots could maybe help us deal with some of the things that are happening that we don't want to happen. So if we have, for example, a problem with not seeing enough people around, like maybe in Japan where they have population growth or decrease problems, you know, robots could maybe even provide a human presence. And so one of the things that is maybe a kind of cross-cutting theme in these kinds of depictions of how we might understand robots is that robots figure as a kind of, and this is a technical term in STS, technological fix for social problems. So we know that we have a lot of social issues that we want to solve. We know that we have, that there are very serious concerns and challenges ahead of us. And, you know, robots are a kind of tool, maybe, that we can use to fix some of these things. However, part of the problem might be, and some of those things are like aging, immigration in Japan, it could be, you know, families with two parents working and needs for childcare, et cetera. And recently, Cynthia Brazil gave a keynote at HRI, and one of the things that she mentioned about Jibo, the kind of home robot that I'm sure you've all seen, at least in advertisement, is that that kind of robot can democratize access to people. So just having that kind of robot, and I've heard this before, actually, when I talked to a Japanese researcher in 2005, he mentioned, well, robotics could be a democratizing technology if we can get it out to enough people. But there's always a question, you know, that people have of, can you really solve societal problems by, you know, focusing just on the technology, right? And one of the things that particularly social scientists studying robotics have criticized early on is that one of the things that, you know, focusing on a robot as an autonomous entity can do is make us forget about the kind of social structures that those technologies have to fit into and that need to be supported by in order to actually work. So when this is just a, I picked a quote from a sociologist. He also happened to be one of my PhD advisors, Sal Restivo. But this is kind of a typical way of thinking of human social, what it means to be social in human terms, which is that it's kind of a dynamic, constantly happening process and that it happens through interaction. Which obviously, in something like human-robot interaction, that's what we want to work on, right? We want to establish this kind of interaction between humans and robots so that they can have some kind of positive social effects, possibly even be interpreted as social agents by people. However, for a long time, what we mostly focused on are kind of studies of one-on-one interactions, so one person with one robot. Recently, and we're doing some of this work as well, there are several people here who I know are doing this. There's kind of a focus on group interactions, so can we have multiple robots, multiple people? But I think there's still not a lot of focus on the bigger picture, right? So the fact that these robots and these people are all part of even bigger units of analysis. So organizations, institutions, you know, things like the Robotics Institute, things like Carnegie Mellon University or the United States, right? And actually when we, this is from a little study that one of my students did, when we look at how people think of robots, versus how researchers think of robots. This is kind of a classification of robots that a researcher did. She just let people sort robots however they wanted. And as you can see, this is kind of a typical, you know, we know the categories that we look at, right? Is it a humanoid, a minimalist robot, an autonomous car? People had no idea. Users, obviously, they don't define them in those ways. They don't really care if it's humanoid or if it's a dog. They want things that are, you know, friendly and I could use it. Or I have no idea what this is for, right? So kind of a very different classification scheme. And so part of what we need to do, yeah?
Do they actually put the labels on it,
This is from the interview. So what they would be doing is they're kind of putting them in groups, and then they're talking about what the groups are for. So yeah, the labels we kind of put on after, according to what they were saying.
But they labeled it.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so one of the challenges is kind of even figuring out how do we go from, you know, our conceptualization of robots to this other, you know, kind of the conceptualization that society or users might have that's very different. And so one of the things that I want to start considering or that we've been considering in our work and are trying to kind of do more of as we go along is trying to think of robots not as just a technological fix for things, but actually as, you know, when you're making robots, designing some kind of socio-technical system so that the social interactions and the kind of technology have to, in a sense, be constructed hand in hand. And I know, as I mentioned, you know, HRI is really good with, or, you know, the thing that we've been focusing on is this face-to-face interaction, often one-on-one. There's also been kind of more work on context. So, you know, maybe the broader ecology, what other kinds of technologies are out there. I think Jody for Lizzie's product ecology is kind of something that fits this viewpoint. But we still don't really have a lot of spread in terms of thinking, well, how do our robots fit like the health insurance system that we have, right? Or, you know, how do they fit maybe the economy, how people work, and the kind of robot that I'm designing, even if it's like picking certain things up or doing something like that, what does this mean for this broader system? So I think one of the things that we need to start considering is kind of how to bridge those two gaps. This one of kind of trying to figure out how robots fit into ever kind of increasingly broader social contexts, and also this difference between the kind of robotics and technical and maybe expert view of robots and the kind of user, more experience-centered view of robots. And so these are the kinds of things we focus on in my lab. So from being the person studying robotics researchers, now I can, I guess, invite people into my lab so they can study me. So we do different things like lab experiments, where we mostly look at psychological theories. Now we're interested in group interaction. But one of the other things that we really kind of focus on and enjoy that I like to do is field studies, or as they're known, in the wild studies. I think I wrote the first one that was called Robots in the Wild from our research here, which was really cool. To understand these kind of social and contextual factors. And now we're also kind of branching into more collaborative design. So figuring out how can we actually work with the populations that we think might be using these robots or might be affected by the robots to kind of take some of their knowledge into the design process, but also to kind of not just assume that they can tell us what they need without knowing something about the robots themselves. So kind of figuring out how to work together and exchange knowledge through more collaborative design processes. So today I'm just going to focus on these two, because the lab experiments are kind of in their own little world, and maybe can be a part of a different talk in the future. And although we do work in different kinds of areas, so we do some cross-cultural work, you know, we've done design for offices and that kind of thing, I'm gonna focus on elder care robots for a few different reasons. One, when I was writing this talk, I actually realized we did a lot of stuff with elder care robots without kind of committing to focus on it. But we've just kind of kept working and working in that domain. And so I have a lot of stories to tell about elder care robots, but also because elder care robots are one of these kind of important central domains to both human-robot interaction and in terms of assistive robots, a kind of population that a lot of work focuses on, which is partly why we focus on them as well. So coming back to this notion of robots as some kind of technological fix, look at papers that talk about robots, and my papers have done this too, there's a tendency, I think now we stop ourselves, like I make my students, I say, nope, we have to have a different beginning. When you start saying, there are a lot of aging people, and we're gonna design a robot, right? So I think we've stopped doing that, but there's still a lot of this focus on how we can develop some kind of autonomy to deal with issues which, you know, people have called, in very flowery, interesting terms, silver tsunami, elder boom, but they're also, which are real challenges, right? But also things that come with that, like lack of caregivers, you know, time, money, economic and psychological cost, right? And so these things are, you know, things that people mention as potentially being addressed by designing robotic technology, but they're also, from our discussions with older adults and their caregivers, there are several things that don't end up being addressed. So things like, what does it mean to be older, right? Or, you know, what do people around the robot, we think of robots as autonomous, but people still need to do a lot of things. Like, you work really hard to make robots do the autonomous robots that do things by themselves, to make them do something, right? And that actually doesn't end when you let them go. Like, people actually have to still be doing stuff to support them. And then also maybe questioning the kind of institutional and societal structures that can make it easier or harder to implement and adopt robots. So I'm going to talk a little bit about different studies that we've done that kind of point to, you know, why these are important problems, and later talk about a little bit about how maybe one way that we can try to address them. So this is, as I mentioned, I'm going to talk about a series of these social studies about how older adults make sense of robots, some of the social factors and invisible labor that we can find in elder care robotics, and also participatory design of robots. So along with being at CMU, the other place that I did research when I was in grad school was in Japan, and I was particularly in the lab that produces Paro. So I'm sure all of you, I'm assuming everybody is familiar with Paro. Yes. And so we've continued kind of using Paro, the therapeutic seal robot, in our research with in elder care for an obvious reason. One, it actually works, so you can leave it with older adults, and we've left it even in a nursing home for a year, and it still works, which I am amazed at. But also because of this kind of idea behind its design, which is kind of an underdetermined design idea. So this is just a quote from Paro's designer, which mentions, you know, Paro has a limited number of functions, but through interaction with humans, it actually can enlarge the number of functions. So in a sense, it fits very well with this social science idea of what it means to be social. It's not that you're social by yourself. It's that you become social through interaction with other people, right? The things that they do and the way that you respond to them and those kinds of things. And so it's kind of, Paro is a useful foil for looking at what is it that people actually put into these interactions with robots. And it also fits well with this idea of the, you know, the difference between how maybe scientists can use and imagine and make sense of Paro in users. So this is just an example. That's Paro in the lab. And I remember when I was in the lab, we used Paro as basically like bricks, kind of, almost, like they were stacked. And, you know, you needed to go to a study and you would just like take a Paro, stick it in a bag and be like, hey, older adults, here's me and my Paro, right? But we didn't really personalize them. We didn't think of them as individuals. Whereas this is Paro in the nursing home, one of the nursing homes in Japan, where the robots actually stayed for a long period of time, many, many years. And there, the Paros were very much individual. They were like people could distinguish them. There were times when, you know, one Paro was broken and the older adult who loved that Paro particularly because it, for example, had longer eyelashes or something, would not play with the other ones because it was waiting for their Paro to come back. Or kind of another way that maybe we as scientists think of robots differently, this is a typical measurement that people will do with Paro to figure out therapeutic efficacy. So this is the amount of a certain enzyme in urine to see whether people are more or less stressed before and after introduction. So the kind of significance of Paro has to do with this metric of kind of effectiveness, right? And this is a haiku that one of the older adults wrote about the robot. So a very different meaning that the older adults have for the robot, you know, that's not this a kind of qualitative experiential meaning, not the kind of quantitative metric. So that's what started us seeing how do people actually, we know that Paro works, so there's been a lot of work saying like, yes, this makes a difference to people, but like, how does it work? Like, what makes the difference? What are some of the mechanisms? Those are kind of the things that we were curious about initially. And so one of the first things that we did is we basically replicated a common way of interacting with Paro, which is you put it in a group, there's some kind of facilitator, usually the therapist, people play with it how they want, it's usually somehow one by one, they share it, they talk, and then the session ends, right? And we saw certain things that were the same as with other people, right? So people, this is just a graph showing people, we observed their behavior. So how much do they look around? How much do they touch Paro? How much do they talk to each other? And we saw an increase kind of over time, over different sessions. There were 8 of them. We saw that people kind of became more active. But one of the things that was interesting was that those kinds of activities were very much affected not just by Paro, but like the physical and social environment. So One day they went outside, everything was much better. One day a very kind of spunky older lady joined the group, everybody was spunkier, right? The therapist's facilitation was super important. In the beginning, the therapist started, was like, I'm not sure what to do with this, and she kind of figured it out later. But another thing that we were particularly thought was interesting is that even the people, when we were observing them, there was not just an individual effect, so the person who's interacting with Paro is more active, but actually there was an effect on the group. So even people who were not interacting with Paro were still paying more attention to what was going on, which was kind of encouraging. But it also suggests that we need to look not just at this individual effect, but actually at the effect on the larger group. Another thing that we did after that in the same nursing home was to actually do this thing where we just put Paro in a public space so that people could use it however they want. And this has also been done in Japan previously, and the finding from that, because the focus was on, well, how effective is it, was that, you know, people got to meet each other more because they talked around Paro. And so we tried to do that, and we couldn't videotape because we're not allowed, but we basically, I had a group of students who sat there and they basically wrote down, as people were interacting with the robot, what was going on. And we expected a lot of interaction to happen, but what happened was that people mostly ignored the robot. So we kind of looked to see how residents interact and how staff interact and how visitors interact, and the highest bar in all cases is like, we ignored it. So they would pass by, look at it, and then just keep going, right? Which is kind of sad when you think about we want our robot to be helping people. But we tried to turn around in the sense of seeing, well, what actually happens? There were some successful interactions, right? There were times when people either indirectly interacted, so just maybe stood and observed Paro for a while, or directly interacted with the robot. And so our question was, well, what's different about the times that people do interact and the times, the use and non-use, basically? And some of the things that we found that were in kind of present in the cases of use were very much different social factors. So things like social mediation, if there was somebody interacting with Paro, already people were much more likely to go and start interacting with it. There were also gender effects, so women were much more likely to go and interact with Paro directly, and men would be more interacting indirectly, although they kind of showed the same interest overall. People, there were certain individuals who interacted with Paro again and again, and one of the things that was interesting is they all interpreted Paro differently. So one of them treated it as a pet. One of them treated it as kind of a way to project her own feelings. She was new, so she would say things like, oh, did they leave you here? Are you lonely? You know, so she was basically speaking through what she was feeling through the robot. My favorite case of somebody using Paro was the lady who only interacted with Paro when she saw somebody else was there, and then she used the robot to get other people to talk to her. And like a social lure, basically. And so I think one of the things that was interesting is that because it had this kind of underdetermined design, people could just fit it into different narratives in different ways, which I think is really important for technologies that have to fit into these human environments that we can't predict kind of beforehand what is each person going to need, right, from the robot. Another thing that we noticed is there was a lot of invisible labor going on. So, for example, in the initial Paro study that we were kind of emulating, there wasn't much discussion of, you know, if people were interacting with Paro, did somebody like call them over, or was somebody there who helped them get used to it? But that's what we actually saw, is that if people, for example, saw somebody interacting with Paro, they would go and they would learn the model of how to interact with it, and then later on they would go and do it themselves. But there was a lot of facilitation that happened both with staff and older adults with each other so that they could actually successfully work with Paro. And then finally, we saw something that we called mutual shaping, but it was basically, we had interviewed staff members before and after, and in the beginning, there were lots of people who were very skeptical. Actually, a lot of them called the robot a toy for the therapists, so there was one therapist who had kind of really wanted to have it in there. But after seeing it in the public and people reacting to it at the end, they became much more, even if it's not, they became much more positive about using robots. Maybe not just Paro, but actually they started thinking and having kind of an imagination of how could we use robots in our daily practice. So there's even this kind of positive effect of being able to see the robot used in your environment that I think is important and that we miss when we have these kind of one-off studies with people who've never seen a robot before, right? We also left the robot with nurses to just do whatever they wanted to with. And we tried to collect data, but they were very busy, so they didn't give us the right data. So this, it got lost. But anecdotally, and I have a little, I don't know how to stop it. Well, we'll see. Anecdotally, we have kind of a description of a particular style of use that we hadn't shown them, that they actually kind of set on themselves.
For the most part, we do use Paro one-to-one. We find that it's more successful, that it gives us a better feel of how the person is responding. In the group setting, it just didn't work as easily because we couldn't maintain people's attention to Paro. They would typically doze off. So we've been using it for our actual scheduled one-to-one visits. There are people who are bedbound or who don't come to any of the group things and who don't initiate their own leisure that we do actual one-to-ones with. They're care planned for that. So we use Paro with that. I've been using him a lot with our students because we have rec therapy students who will help us with our one-to-one visits and really just for them to be able to see the success that we have with Paro.
Right, so they kind of found their own, what really worked for them and their environment and the people that they worked with. So this kind of, to me, this is an example of, you know, why we need to look at this more organizationally, kind of at a bigger level, right? Not just like both in maybe the group interaction, how it fits the institution, and how maybe we can have different kinds of uses of robots working with, you know, therapists and the people who live there. And more recently, we've started doing a study with an organization that has kind of four different healthcare buildings for older adults where they have used Paro and some other robots. In two cases they're successful, in two cases they're not successful, they basically stopped using it. So what we're trying to figure out is what are the things that basically got them to use the robot successfully in some cases and what didn't. And I have some kind of descriptions of the different institutions here. But for example, in the first one, it's a nursing home, there are 90 residents, people work in small groups. All the staff members know the robot, they use it regularly, you know, there it works. In the second one, it's hospice, 30 residents, once again small. They had some issues with infection control, but now they're developing new uses, kind of like our, in our initial example, people first didn't know what to do with it, but they're kind of figuring out how to adapt it to their environment. And the last two, in one, Paro is like nobody knows where it is anymore. And in the final one, there are 300 residents, so it turned out that it was too big for the use of Paro because they couldn't, basically they were afraid, they had a lot of work to do, but they were also afraid to just leave people alone with the robot because it's so expensive. So they were afraid somebody would like lose it or forget it or break it or even just give it to somebody who asked for it because people there have dementia. So they stopped using Paro, but now they're considering the Joy for All cat, which I don't know if anybody has seen that, but it's like a $100 robot that is much simpler than Paro. Let's say it that way. So obviously these kind of organizational factors can matter a great deal in terms of figuring out adoption. And one of the things in all of these cases was that actually there was, particularly in this one, in each case where it was successful, there was a human who was a great champion of the robot. Like they really pushed for everybody to like learn how to use it. They were positive about it even when things weren't going right. So in a sense, you need these kind of, like one other thing is you need these champions. You need people who are going to really commit themselves to making it work, right? So just in terms of thinking how to design HR within a social and organizational context, you know, maybe we can think of taking the focus away from designing just the autonomy, but thinking about how to design it assuming that people are going to put in some labor into making the system work. I think that's okay, right? And so bringing attention to this kind of invisible labor that people already do, and thinking about how it fits the workflow and capabilities of the organization. And one of the things is also this, there's kind of a term in technology studies which talks about a virtuous circle. So often when we have a technology that works out, like Facebook, we say, oh yes, it was the best one out there. But that's not often the case. It's more that people were like, oh, we like this one, let's commit to it and let's make it work, right? Which they call the virtuous circle. So how do you set that up with robots? Where, you know, people first see it succeeding and they're like, let's commit more resources, and therefore it's kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy in a sense. So that was about Paro, or kind of socially assistive robots in institutions. But another area that we've been looking at is socially assistive robots in the home. And these are just some examples of what children will do to robots if you let them. I let my colleagues take them home because their kids love Paro. So these are two. This was somebody got Paro for Christmas, somebody got Paro for Easter. Paro has also worn a tutu. It's all open. But how will people deal with these kind of technologies when they can have them in their home environment? So one of the first studies we did about asking people about robots in the home was just this kind of open-ended interview with older adults, showing them all the kinds of robots that people have developed for older adults and saying, like, what do you think about this? Like, what do you like about it? What don't you like about it? Would you use it? And the kind of theme that came out from all of that questioning had to do with, the robots look really cool, but not for me. Like, I don't need one, I don't want one, but it would be great for somebody, you know, really old, really needing help, but definitely not for me. And another thing that they pointed out is what they disliked about some of the robots, and we showed them both pictures, but also just videos showing how people are seeing, like what people are imagining how the robot is used. So like the Carobot video, if you've ever seen it, where, you know, the robot is in the person's home and it's carrying stuff and giving them something. And they said that what they really had a problem with was the stereotype of aging that was being designed into the robot. So the fact that aging was seen mainly as a disability, as a problem, as a disease, and that the robots were designed mainly to deal with all the disease disability issues that aging might bring. And what some of them said was like, actually, that is one of the hardest things for me about aging, is that people look at me and they say, oh, she's an old granny, she doesn't know anything, right? But I actually do. So the stereotype that society is kind of bringing onto them, they see it in the robot, and that's why they, you know, they don't want to have that kind of technology in their home. And one of the things that they were saying is, there are actually things in my life as a person who's retired or who's aging that I really enjoy. Like, I enjoy not having to go to work and be in the rat race. I can choose what I'm doing, right? And so I would rather have designs that are kind of trying to expand on the joyful aspects rather than focusing on the negatives, right? And another thing that we saw is that they actually, in terms of the challenges of aging, they had much broader visions of what was the problem. So some of the things that they talked about, I mentioned the stereotypes, but they also talked about kind of societal institutional problems that they had. So this one individual, she was a female, she had some mobility impairment, and one of the things that she was saying is, you know, it's the town, it's not designed for me. That's what makes it difficult, right? But otherwise, she saw herself, even though she was kind of mobility impaired, we had them just do this thing where they kind of had put down five words about what they think about themselves and aging, etc. And in terms of herself, she saw herself as a dancer, right? And her aging is kind of something that brings her wisdom. Another thing you probably won't be surprised is insurance. They brought up health insurance as like something that makes their aging, as this guy said up there, suck, right? So that it's not just things that the disabilities that people might experience, but actually these kind of broader societal issues that we aren't necessarily even touching with our technology that are really at the core of the problems that they're facing. So as a result of all this prior work with older adults and institutions, one of the things that we've started doing is trying to figure out how can we try to design robotic systems together with the older adults. So we've been trying to apply participatory design, which was a kind of way of designing computerization into workplaces that started being developed in the 70s in Scandinavian countries. trying to apply that to kind of developing, trying to figure out how can we use this to try to figure out what kinds of robots people might want to use and what they would use them for in homes. And so we also, there is a small number of kind of participatory design studies in robotics already. I think there's more interest in this arena, and so that's what we've been trying to do recently. And so we've done two series of participatory design workshops with two groups of older adults, one in a more rural setting and one in a more urban setting, kind of looking at these questions, like what are their experiences, how do they perceive assistive technology, and what do they think the design goals should be? What do they want to do with this stuff? And so we've been kind of trying to figure out also, there's not really a particular method that's developed for older adults or for design in the home. Participatory design was initially developed for larger organizations where people have specific roles. So, you know, different workers might be brought in, but it's clear what they do and what the goal is. In the home, the goal is not so clear, right? You live there, hopefully happily. And healthily. So we're trying to figure out how do we design with people. Or people who generally don't think about robots, right? And the first thing we kind of focused on was a notion that goes through all of participatory design, which is mutual learning. So how do you get the different stakeholders? Sometimes they can be, you know, in an organization, it would be managers, workers, you know, the technology experts, right? How do you get them to learn about each other, each other's experiences, what they all know, and then share that information and then design together from there? So what we've tried to do so far is do some initial interviews just to get to know people, but then also do a series of workshops where we introduce older adults and clinicians to assistive robots, try to design robots together with them, show them some like sensors and robotic parts and stuff like that, and just see where that gets us. So we're not going to get a robot in the end, just to tell you. Not yet. But we're kind of trying to move into the direction of basically having some informed discussions with older adults where we understand them better and they understand robots better. So just to show you some of the things that come out of this, so these are some things from the interviews. We did the initial interviews in their homes, partly to be somewhere where they're more comfortable than we are, and then also to see what their homes are like. As you can see, the homes of these older adults don't look anything like the nice apartments that we see in videos of robots, right? There's lots of clutter, there's all kinds of things going on there. And we also kind of talked to them about both the technologies they use, but also artifacts that they really care about in their environment. And aside from seeing their homes, we learned a little bit about things. We worked with older adults with depression. We learned about some things that they found really challenging. So loneliness, obviously, big one. The fact that they use social interaction as therapy, so any social connection made them always feel better. But also that they, you know, we called it a disability culture, but they talked about being part of like this group where, you know, they can't work, they can't really get out of their house because they don't have money for transportation, and so they don't feel very useful in society. And also the issue of lack of funding is something that came up. And so after kind of talking to them, just focusing on their issues and problems, we also showed them a lot of different kinds of robots, videos of them. They also had an opportunity to interact with some robots like Paro, Roomba, you know, Keepon, other kinds of stuff. They saw some telepresence robots. And we asked them about what they liked about them. And I mean, they liked Paro. They liked Keepon. But one of the things that they liked about Paro, of course it was cute, but they also saw some of the videos where people were interacting with Paro and with each other, and the thing that they really liked was the atmosphere, the camaraderie that was in those videos, right? So in a sense, it kind of helps us understand that it's not just particular aspects of the robot, but this kind of result or this the social environment that they were really interested in recreating. We also worked with them to design, to kind of try to envision some robot designs that they were interested in. So these are just, obviously we brought one of the HCI design students with us who could actually draw. I can't. And he stood there, and as they talked about things they wanted, he would basically make a picture of it. And then they would look at the picture, and they would say, like, no, that's wrong. You know, I don't want that. I want this. But we basically tried to use pictures so that they could immediately see what something like that might look like in the eyes of a designer and kind of give us immediate feedback on what was going on. So these are just kind of some of the some of the things they said they wanted. Connected to this notion of loneliness as being their main problem, a lot of companionship functions came up as things that they really desired. Appearance, they still wanted it to be like a robot. This one's tough. Everybody wanted to take their robot everywhere. So I know everybody's cringing, but they really wanted to be able to take it outside and go and sit on a park bench and, look outside with it. But also, obviously, ease of use. So one of the things we had our plan initially was to basically in our second session to bring some like little bits and Arduino pieces and start making things. And we had a little robot prototype that was programmable in the first session. And we asked them, do you want to just like type in something for it to say? And they were like, no, we don't want to touch the computer, like nothing to do with the computer. So we kind of eased off of the let's work together and build robots immediately. But that's very important. Like they had a lot of anxiety with having to control the robot. In the next workshop, we kind of worked with them further. We went from their home plan. We had them talk about how they use their house and then try to design a robot that fit into that use. So we got to know a little bit more about kind of which spaces of the house they wanted the robot to go into and which spaces they didn't. Have a kind of more holistic picture of what the robot could do in their home. And we also got to talk a little bit about privacy concerns. So obviously, have the robot. Some people were fine with having it go to the bathroom. Some people would not, et cetera, et cetera. And then finally, we got to the designing part. So we brought some different sensors to show them, but we really had them kind of take their robot pictures and then add sensor cards to them. So different kind of sensors that might be part of their robots to tell us what they think the robots should do, what kinds of things they should collect, what kind of information they should collect, how they should respond in the environment. And at the very end of this, that's where we ended up with the older adults, but then we went to the clinicians and we showed them some of the results. And we actually got really interesting feedback from them in the sense of how you could take some of the requirements and things that the older adults wanted and turn them into a more, like fit them into the therapeutic process that they were undergoing. So one of the things that the older adults said is like, oh yes, it would be great to have robots tell us, what I'm supposed to eat and what I'm not supposed to eat. And then the clinician said, well, that's interesting, but when we do this with the older adults, we don't tell them don't eat that. We ask them questions like, are you sure you want to eat that? So that they can actually make the decision themselves, right? And they can work through that problem of, is this a good thing to do, right? And then it's their own thing. So I think that was a nice way of, we particularly didn't put therapists into the sessions because we didn't want the older adults to kind of be quiet. We didn't want the hierarchical relationship basically between the therapist and the older adult to make it difficult for older adults to tell us what they were thinking. So one of the things is I think it is possible to use participatory design with these populations, though it's harder in the context of the home because the kind of goal and the aim is not as clear. The older adults and therapists were really willing to participate. One of the problems we had is that the older adults initially started as thinking of themselves as consumers, so they would constantly talk about, I would buy this, or I wouldn't buy that. But we really needed them to think more as designers. So what kind of things should this have? How would other people that are like you, not just you, how could they use a robot? But one of the other things that was really hopeful was that even just being part of the participatory design workshops was beneficial to older adults. So I often had their therapists calling me asking me when's the next workshop, because it turned out that this was one of the few times that they had social interactions. And so in a sense, and even just being there and feeling like somebody cared about what they were saying was in a sense beneficial to them. So that's a good thing. And so hopefully, and they are interested in doing more of this kind of stuff. So what are we doing next? We've been doing some in-home implementations of robots with Paro, so putting it in people's homes with sensors to both see how we can use kind of sensor data from the robot to understand something about the health status of older adults, and also to see what they're going to do with the robot. if they have a long period of time in which to interact with it. And so we're done with that. We collected data. Results will be out, probably submitted to HRI in the fall. And then we also have been doing some community robotics in elder care institutions. So I have a student who's very interested in thinking about how to design robots with community goals in mind, not just individual goals. And so we'll be doing some work on that. So in the future, as you're developing your robots, I just want to suggest, you know, kind of questioning autonomy and thinking about this way of getting people engaged in supporting the robot. You know, trying to figure out what are users' experiences and really their main issues and designing for that. And also maybe creating more opportunities for collaborative design. So I want to thank you and all the people who participated, all my students, people who gave us money, and also to invite you to HRI in Chicago in 2018. October 6th is the deadline. Plenty of time to write papers. So, you know, join us. But I'm open to questions.
Thank you for the great talk. So you're obviously very careful and thoughtful about the way you do your research. How do you respond to the inevitable critique that you're trying to replace social interaction with robotic interaction?
Well, I think in a sense, when you're talking about how to fit the robot into like these organizational settings, I think you're already taking like a view of there are still going to be people there and they're going to be doing things. And so how does the robot support them? I mean, one of the things that I think is nice about taking this view is also that when we do the observations on an organizational level, we notice things that you normally might not notice if you're focusing on a particular function. So I'll give you an example. When we were doing the observational studies of PARO and of people using PARO in the public space, since we were just tracking what everybody was kind of doing and how they were interacting with not just the robot but with each other, one of the things that we notice is that the janitorial staff are the people who most often just kind of in an impromptu, spontaneous way go up to the older adults and ask them, how are you today, what are you doing? Because they're the ones who have a little bit of time. The nurses are always running around. And so they don't have time to stop, but the janitorial staff do. So normally I think we would say, well, cleaning everybody hates, so we could make some robots and get rid of the cleaning, right? But if you actually get rid of the janitorial staff, you also get rid of this thing that's not part, so that's part of the invisible labor, right? They're actually giving social support when it's not part of their job. So I think that's, I mean, basically, the question is kind of, if you take a broader view, then you might notice some of these patterns that aren't obvious and, you know, try to, you know, maybe make sure to not, maybe give the janitorial staff some more extra time so they could stop by rather than getting rid of them completely, right? So, I don't know. I hope that helps. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah.
So, this thing about community versus individual,
mm-hmm.
Often it's a trade-off,
mm-hmm.
right? And I'm wondering if you have some thoughts about how the technology can be situated to bridge that trade-off, you know, the individual good versus the community good.
Mm-hmm. So I think, I mean, as far as I can tell, I think robots need the support of the community, basically, these days, to really operate. Like an individual by themselves, so an individual older adult, however much they might love the robot, right? They can't really upkeep it and maintain it or even get really introduced to it appropriately without the help of some other people in the community. So I think, at least in kind of the abilities of robots that we have now, but I think this will be like that in the future. We can't really think of the individual without, you know, this kind of social structure and the things that support it. I'm not saying that the interaction, you know, the end interaction won't be an individual interaction, right? So it could be people take PARO and they hang out with it in the room, and really the end benefit that they get is from hanging out with PARO in their room for 30 minutes, right? And that's the kind of dyadic interaction that they have. But getting PARO there, getting them introduced to it in the right way so that they end up having a positive interaction by themselves in the room will have to do with basically the community somehow making an effort and kind of committing to using the robot in a way, in that way to make it happen. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So I guess I was thinking, so I'll give you some anecdotes about so with Roboceptionist, we designed it explicitly for one-on-one interaction. And when we saw the types of interactions that occurred, they tended to be small group interactions.
Right.
Very, very frequently. Where people would, you know, let me show you what I found out, or they would take turns and stuff like that. And the robot really wasn't handling it very well. So when we developed the game playing robot, the traveling robot and games, the explicit design was we wanted it to be something that an individual could do by themselves, but if there was a small group, it would facilitate that. So
yep, I played with it this morning for after lunch.
Didn't swear at you. Was doing the right thing. And you know, so that was an explicit design decision, and I, you know, I'm assuming that with some of these, you know, other, you know, institutional based robots, that there could be similar types of things where, I mean, Paro really is in and of itself is an individualist. People can interact between themselves, but there's only one person interacting with the robot. So are there other things that you can think of for that type of setting where it's you can either do the individual or the group interaction depending on what the person, you know, I mean, if Paro could somehow, you know, not just look at the person who's interacting with it, but you know, turn to the, you know, the neighbor and make comments and bring them in if they're.
Yeah, so we actually, when we did this, my student who's interested in the community robotics approach, which is like developing robots for community goals, I don't think they're mutually exclusive. So I think basically by saying we need to make like organization, think about the organization, I think that the individual interaction is definitely part of it. So one of the things that we kind of extracted from that study, she went and she talked to people in a retirement home and about first, like, what does community mean to them? What's their community like? But then also showing them lots of robots and being like, what could you do with this, right? And so first it turned out that the biggest problem in their community is the fact that there's a lot of turnover. And so people either pass away or sometimes new people are constantly coming in. They can't remember who's who. And so then they're reticent to talk to them, right? Even though they've seen, they're like, I've seen this person before, but I can't tell who it is, right? And so one of the things that they really wanted is somehow to have like the robot, for example, come to them, so it's an individual interaction, and somehow help them figure out who these people are, and then, you know, then they could go, or, you know, maybe kind of get them together, right? So I think you can have that. You still definitely have to have the individual interaction. It's just, I think, different when you think of, well, we're having the individual interaction to serve the community goal of having these people talk to each other versus we're having the individual interaction to serve the goal of making this person feel like they're having being interacted with socially, right? Does that make sense? So I think they're different goals. And sometimes I think we might distract from, I mean, the goal might be to distract them from the robot, or the goal might be to have them really not pay attention to the robot for too long, right? To just have the robot as like a signpost, like Mary likes bridge too, and her name is Mary, right? Or you saw Mary last when you were talking to her in the cafeteria about her son, right? So, if you're still thinking,
huh? I love that idea. Robot is memory aid. You know, a social robot is memory aid.
Yeah, and they had others. So all of their things had to do with social. We submitted a paper to Romance, so fingers crossed. But it was all about social enablement. So one was this just telling people. The other one was like getting people like together so they could go out and like do an activity together or something like that. But yeah, I can send you the preprint version. Yeah.
Elder care type of application with people who are already kind of old. You run similar experiments with a little bit younger people, right?
Which ones?
Like people in the 40s, 50s, who are going to become further.
Oh, you're talking about the ones that were in the home.
Right, right. So mm-hmm. the interaction model may be very different.
Mm-hmm.
These people are already familiar with things like smartphones. They are not afraid of using more technology.
Yeah, so the in-home studies we did with actually people like baby boomers, because we were thinking, you know, the people who are already old are probably not going to be using the robots because they're not going to be ready by then. It's more the baby boomer generation that's maybe going to have an opportunity to use some of these technologies. So the ones that we talked to in the home about, the ones that didn't want robots for themselves, is that the one you're talking about? Yeah, so those ones were in their like 50s, like 50 to 60, right?
This ties to the question I was going to ask.
Mm-hmm.
So that comment of, you know, I think other people would like that, but not for me,
mm-hmm.
is exactly what people say about hearing aids.
Right.
Hearing aids are a badge of getting old.
Right,
and
right.
So I'm wondering, are we kind of setting ourselves up for these types of robots to be the badge of getting old?
They could be, yeah, and especially because I think what's more interesting there the not for me is just kind of a call to, well, we have to be careful because they don't want them, right?
Right.
But the thing that was interesting to me is the thing that they were pushing back against was the stereotype. So we know with assistive technologies, like, people don't like assistive technologies that look like they're assistive because it's stigmatizing, right? You don't want to wear thing you press. Yeah, because it's this kind of huge white thing with a red button, and it just, it's not nice, right? So people, HCI people have designed things like a more decorative jewelry-like button, right? Or something that doesn't, so I think taking it away, so making it instead of assistive, helping you with your disability, but more, one example that one of the participants gave us in terms of like what's a good technology for me was she purchased one of the bicycles that has a motor. And so, you know, when she's biking around, the motor can kick in places where it's just hard to get up a hill, right? And so she's still doing an activity that she loves to do. She's kind of, but it's just, and it's not, you know, she's not disabled in a sense, but it's just helping her get more out of something that she enjoys rather than focusing on something like, well, you're cognitively declining, or, you know, you're just not capable. So it's kind of a reformulating it of, let me just kind of make you able to do what you're enjoying more, rather than saying like, oh, you're going to have all of these problems. You're not going to hear, you're not going to be able to walk, you're not going to be able to do this. Let's focus on those, right? So I think kind of the reframing, even though it's doing a similar thing, but kind of reframing it so that the stereotype isn't so obvious, seems to be something that would help. Yeah.
So kind of a follow-up of that, it seems like this idea of thinking of robots even higher level than just groups, right? Like, as a very, community-driven process. It might be an interesting framework for thinking about ethics in this space. And so I was wondering if you have any particular thoughts on this process and how that might help to figure out problems right now, even with, like, autonomous cars, right? Very, very immediate problems that may come up, you know, in this space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think then you do end up with questions that have to do with, like, not just how does a person, for example, how do they interact? Do they trust the car? How do they interact with something when they get in it? Or do they get in it? Or how does a pedestrian look at it? But then you can start thinking about issues like, how does it change the dynamics of driving in a city, right? I think somebody did a simulation, I think, with Singapore, where, because Singapore is kind of self-contained, they looked at what would happen if we basically switched all cars into autonomous cars. And so you could, one, not have as much parking, they would just be like rolling around and, but nobody would have their own car, who would actually, are there people who would have a problem with that? So yeah, I think you can reframe it in that sense, and then you might have some, it might bring up different ethical issues, so deciding kind of not just what's the effect on the individual, but what might be this bigger consequence of having something. But also you can start thinking about things which I think about built environment, like, how does our environment change if we have some of these technologies and we're thinking of them as being used by a bigger group, not just like one-on-one, right? So more, thank you. I think that's more the stuff to think about.
So it's a little after 4:30. Post-seminar reception, the PSR, is right next door, and that goes from 4:30 to 6. 6:30. She has to run to the airport at 6. So this is a wonderful opportunity to corner her, ask her more questions, one-on-one.
I'll just stand in the corner right now.
At least this way you all have food and snacks and other things like that, okay? So once again, thank you.
Thank you, this was really fun.